privilege to be here today. Whenever I get a chance to speak, I feel like it's holy ground. And so as we are hanging out together, just remember that this is a very beautiful time in your life where you have set aside, sanctified a period of time to not only grow in what your understanding is as of a writer, but in your understanding of just who you are, as Ted mentioned earlier. So we're going to talk about three stories today and your irresistible future in publishing. And everyone loves that, right? Like we love, okay, because I'm going to publish and I'm going to have books and it's going to be awesome. And I'll start by just saying one thing. Publishing will not validate your life. Just remember that. It will not make you a better person. It will not fill the deepest need in your soul. I can stand before you with 30 books under my belt and say it doesn't. So be very cautious about thinking that at the end of this conference, you're going to get published and then it will validate who you are, because it doesn't. So there are three stories that we need to embrace if we want to have this irresistible future in publishing. And the first story is the past story. And this is a picture of France. This is a church that I walked by every single day as we took our kids to school. And it was beautiful and the food was awesome and everything. But there's a little bit of a story underneath that, and that has to do with my story of a writer. So I started writing in the beginning of the 90s, in the days of yore, in the ancient days prior to the internet, when Al Gore invented it, supposedly. And that was the days where you actually sent query letters, you printed them off, stuck them in a thing called an envelope, put a stamp on it, waited 4,000 years to get your mimeographed rejection that had been, you know, copied so many times you couldn't even read it anymore. So I've paid my dues, and I used to save all those. I kind of thought that wasn't a good idea anymore, so I threw them out. But I've had a lot of rejection. So I started in the beginning of the 90s writing these words. And seriously, like thousands and thousands and millions of words, paying my dues, doing what Malcolm Gladwell talks about in Outliers as the 10,000-hour rule, where if you want to master something, you spend 10,000 of your favorite hours writing. So this is what I did, and I had little kids at the time, and so I was, you know, hurting them, and not hurting, but herding, and maybe I was doing both, but I was busy with them, but I was also just writing, and just had this dream that I believed God had formed in me that I was going to be a writer. And even prior to that, I had always been a speaker. I'd been speaking since I was, you know, since I became a Christian. And so here I was in the 90s, and I was writing in obscurity. And I will say this too, do not despise those days of small beginnings. Do not despise your obscurity, because that is the very dark cave that God uses to change you forever and to give you depth in what you write. So many of us want to jump ahead of God and we want to make something happen of our lives, but we need to not despise that dark place. And so the 90s, also a dark time in music history, but the 90s were my dark cave, and I wrote all these words. And in 1998, we moved, we called it our first cross-cultural ministry move. We moved from Seattle, Washington to Palestine, Texas, where they actually, this man came up to me, and he was in our church, and he was kind of a hunchback. It was kind of a little bit weird. And we had a church potluck, and I brought ham and bean soup, and this man came up to me, and he goes, "What's in this here stew?" And I was like, "I don't even understand what he's saying." And I said, "Well, it seemed obvious to me, because there was chunks of ham in there, and there were beans." And I said, "It's ham and bean soup." And he said, "It tastes just like my mama's possum stew." And I was like, "Oh, la, 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 la." So I was a little bit freaked out. And so that was our first cross-cultural move. In 2000, we moved to Dallas, you know, the land of the free. And my husband went to Dallas Seminary because he had gone to a promise keeper, promise maker, whatever it's called, conference. And he, while he was there worshiping God, God said, "I want you to be a pastor." He came home from that conference when we lived in Palestine, and he said, "I have something very important to tell you." And I thought to myself, I thought, "Oh, he's, you know, addicted to porn, or he's had an affair," because it sounded very, like, important. And or he's gone to this men's conference. He's going to be super nice to me for 1 week, and then that's over. So he's like, I have something important to tell you. Tells me, he goes, I think God's calling me to be a pastor. And I should have just been just as alarmed, because that is a scary thing to do. We go to Dallas. He goes to Dallas Theological Seminary. He goes for 4 years, gets his THM, church planning, all that stuff, and we go to France. Meanwhile, in the year 2000, I start thinking that I can dust off this publishing dream where I've been working 8 years on this dream. And I go to this little tiny church, and we don't go to this church anymore, but it disbanded. I guess that shows our history of church. But we go to this little church, and I'm at a church potluck, another potluck. Things happen at potlucks. You really need to go to potlucks. I'm at this church potluck, and I sit down next to this lady, and she says, so what do you want to be when you grow up? And it takes me, I have this internal battle. Have you ever had this where you're like, should I say I want to be a writer? Should I say it out loud? I'm super embarrassed, and I'm battling and wondering if I should do that. And finally, I blurt it out. I don't know why, but I just do. And I say, I think I want to be a writer. And she looks at me, and she goes, do you know that one of my passions in life is to mentor new writers? She was a professor at the seminary, unbeknownst to me, in the media arts department, Sandra Glahn, and she took me under her wing, which is so powerful. We all need mentors in our lives. So she took me under her wing, and she helped me write my first real query letter that actually got a handwritten note back. And by the time we were ready to leave to go to France in 2004, I had been to a major writers conference. I had landed an agent. I was only a novelist at that time. That's my primary gift is novel writing. And I had sold two parenting books. And so when we were on the verge of going to this place in France, I thought in my mind, it's over. I had a limiting view of God. I believed that I had done all this, and in my mind, I thought, okay, I'm just going to sacrifice it all for Jesus. I'm going to go to a foreign mission field, and my publishing dream, even though I'm having a couple published, it is going to die. I had a very limited view of the greatness of God. And my encouragement to you today is not to have a limited view of the greatness of God. So there's a scripture I want to share with you. And the cool thing about this scripture is that it's in six verses. So we're going to talk about three stories, the past story, the present story, and the future story. And each one has two verses corresponding with it. So if you ever need to write a sermon, just use this. It'll be great. The past story, Isaiah 43, 16 through 21, says, I am the Lord who opened a way through the waters, making a dry path through the sea. I called forth the mighty army of Egypt with all its chariots and horses. I drew them beneath the waves and they drowned, their lives snuffed out like a smoldering candlewick. Now that sounds kind of crabby and not very much fun, but what this is about is deliverance. It's about what God has done in the past. And if you are a writer, you have to go back there. You have to go to the past. You have to uncover the stuff from the past. And in doing so, you need to recount the greatness of God in your past. And so as I was standing on foreign soil, and as I was crying every day, and as it was so hard, and as I was trying to communicate in another language, and as my dream of publishing was crumbling to the ground, I had to learn to remind myself of the greatness of God in the land of the living, that he was capable of doing whatever the heck he wanted to do. And all I needed to do was look back on my own story and see that it was true. But we are a forgetting generation, am I not right? We forget. And you see it throughout the whole Bible. The Lord says, remember, 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 remember. And I think that there were times when I lived in France where the depression would set in and I could not remember the greatness of God. I forgot that he had delivered me from enemies. I forgot about all of the angst of my childhood of being a sexual abuse victim at age 5 every single day of my kindergarten career, of a father taking his life when I was 10 years old, of a mom who's thrice divorced and pot plants growing in the closet, which is now legal in some states. And all of this like deprivation and pain, and God just saw fit to rescue me at 15 years old, set my feet upon a rock and make my footsteps firm and change everything about me. Fundamentally, I'm no longer a victim. I am someone who is healed by the Lord. I am loved by my Father, even though I don't have an earthly father, but I had forgotten that. In your journey as a writer, you must remember the past and the greatness of God. If you are discouraged today, just start writing down, what has God done in your life? What are the chariots that he has slayed for you? What are the things that God has done for you? Remember, remember the past. Remember the faithfulness of God. It is his desire that you think about these things and you remember. But now we need to run to the present story. And this is story two. This is what's going on right now. And this is actually a picture of a redbud tree that is in our front yard. And my word for the year this year is trust. And so I have this image right next to my desk and with the word trust written across. So the scripture says, again from Isaiah, but forget all that. What? It is nothing to compare to what I am going to do, for I am about to do something new. See, I've already begun. Do you not see it? I will make a pathway through the wilderness. I will create rivers in the dry wasteland. So God says we must remember. We must go to the past. We must get all the gritty stuff out of there. We must mine it for what it is worth, but we also must live in the great present tense. We serve the great I am, not the great I was, not the great I will be, the great I am in the present tense. We must be present in our lives. We must occupy our lives. We must be aware that our God can do different things in the present. And that applies to our writing career actually quite well. I know a lot of friends of mine who were published in the glory years of Christian publishing, which were the 90s, even though it was a bad music era. And some of you are going to argue with me afterwards. But you're like, no, it was the best. They were getting contracts, and the publishers actually, they were like super excited about marketing your book, and it was great, and they were selling 50, 100,000 copies of their books. And they have learned that that was the heyday of publishing. And so they have nostalgized the past. And we have to be really careful about thinking about the glory days and always thinking that that is the only way that God works in those glory days. If we live like that, we no longer allow God to be creative today. This great I am, the creator of the universe, we think, okay, well, he delivered me from the chariots before. Therefore, as I pray, he will deliver me from the chariots today. But that is not necessarily how God will work. The scripture says, forget all that. It is nothing compared to what I am going to do, which means as a writer, you need to live in this holy expectancy, this desire for adventure, that God can be absolutely unique in your life, and it is going to look different than the person on your left and the person on your right, and you can compare yourself if you want to other people, but it will only make you upset, and it will not keep you in this articulate place where you are asking God, please be unique in my life. Please do something right now, brand new, rivers in the desert. I love that imagery of a dry, dry place and God pouring water on it. That's how God works with us. We need to let him be creative, as I said. We need to not make the past and the way God has worked in the past as an idol. It cannot be. Let's let God be original with us and in our writing careers. And that's where I'm at today in the present tense story. I have seen God work in the past. I have seen great things happen. And I'm expecting them to happen again. And I am not allowing God to do something different and unexpected. I was speaking to my friend Susie this morning, and we were talking about how oftentimes, and Esther will attest to this, I'm a very obedient author. If you send a guru my way, and they say, Mary, in order to sell your books, you need to do these 10 things, I will do them, and I will check them off because I'm so very obedient. And the Lord never lets it work. And I thought about that a lot. I'm like, why? Why, Lord? Why won't this work? I want this to work. And he has whispered to me so many times, what if it did work? You would be able to point to a person, point to a method, point to your tenacity and how awesome you are to see the success and give the glory somewhere else where it does not belong. So let God be unique, but let him do something cool, unexpected. Don't work so dang hard. Sometimes we have to do the thing called surrender, and we have to take our career or even our little story or whatever, wherever it is on our journey. If we're speakers, we have to lay it down and say, I don't know what is supposed to be, but God, be the great I am right now. Let me be present in my life and whisper to me what you want me to do. So this morning, every day for Lent, I've been creating art. It's been super fun. And this next slide is from that. And the Lord gave me this verse for you this morning. And so I just, this was my little art thing that I did. The verse is from 3 John 1:2, and it says this, Beloved, I pray that in all respects you may prosper and be in good health just as, or in the same manner as, your soul prospers. We live in an upside-down kingdom where we think success as a Christian writer must look a certain way. And yet this scripture says you will have success as, or just as, your soul prospers. So my wish for you in the present tense living is that your soul, as Ted talked about before, will overflow with joy and love and affection and forgiveness and a lack of bitterness, that this soul will prosper. And as you see that your soul prospering is the best thing, nothing else is going to matter as much. You will want to set the glory and give the fame to the one who deserves it instead of trying to gather it for yourself to fill yourself up with something that never fills. So the present tense story about the great I am, and the last one is the future. This is a picture of some friends I made in Ghana, and of course they're waving because they're so happy and sweet. And when I think about our writing career, and some of you may not be on this path, I mean, you might be writing technical journals or whatever, but no matter what, even if you separate yourself out from your writing career, I believe that God wants to do something really awesome in the world, not just with you as an individual, but us collectively as a group of people. We're going to leave this room and we're going to go change the world and we're going to change the landscape of the kingdom of God with our words. And it's going to be awesome. It'll be fun in heaven when we regather and we talk about Rewrite 2015 and what God had brought together, the great amount of people that he brought together to just change the world with words. And I think that is God's heart for us. He wants us to band. He wants us to have community. And as I've mentioned before in other talks, the thing that often injures us is the thing that God uses to heal us. So if you have been injured in broken community, unfortunately, God asks you to step back into community to be healed with positive community. Some of you, I wasn't intending to say that this morning, so I think the Lord has that for someone in this room. You've been injured, you've been hurt, and you think, I'm never going to trust another person again, I'm going to create a wall, and I'm not going to go forward. But then you will miss changing the world. And let me tell you, that is exciting. Changing the world, it helps you to forget all the stuff in the past. It helps you to engage in the present. And it helps you to have a view of the future, a heavenly perspective, where God someday will say, well done, good and faithful servant who did things that nobody noticed. He notices those quiet things that you do. And God is the God of the unseen who rewards those who faithfully serve him. I have a friend who, her ministry is writing cards to people, and you would not notice her. She's the kind of person that stays in the back of the room. Sorry for all you people in the back of the room. And I love her, but she is an unnoticed person. I have chosen to notice her because I think she's awesome. But there are some of you in this room who feel unnoticed, but you matter. Your card that you write to someone, that kind of writing is going to change the world. Forget about all these books and things. Writing one card to one person will change the world. It will. It'll change the world of the person that you're writing it to. So the last scripture is the future, and this is where I'm going to get excited. I haven't been excited yet, so here we go. The wild animals in the fields, here you guys are, the wild animals in the fields, will thank me, the jackals and the owls too, for giving them water in the desert. Yes, I will make rivers in the dry wasteland so my chosen people can be refreshed. I have made Israel, now stick your name in there, for myself. I have made Bob for myself. If you're Bob, that's for you. And they will someday honor me before the whole world. And Christy will honor me someday before the whole world. The goal of what God was doing with the Israelites was never just about them. And you see kind of the failure of that problem toward the end of the Old Testament. And that's why they missed Jesus. They didn't quite understand what he was doing. God's heart was that Israel would be a light on a hill, that they would be a beacon to show the power of God and to show the awesomeness of God. It was always about the whole world. But Israel tended to stay within their bubble. And it was God's heart always to change the landscape of the kingdom of God with his people, his chosen people. And we are his holy priesthood. We are his chosen people. We are that city on a hill. And our job on this earth is to proclaim him in front of the whole world. I have made you for myself, and you will someday honor me before the whole world. The end game is that, I think. And it doesn't matter, you could be a plumber and that, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you do. You don't even have to write words. You can be a plumber for the kingdom of God's sake. You could change that landscape. I believe that there is going to be in heaven a great cloud of readers who will greet us, finally. Bestseller in heaven, whoo! And they are going to, it's going to be so much fun to see those people that we didn't even know we had an effect on, and the conversations and the joy that we're going to have. We need to live for that great cloud of readers, for the next life, for the future life. We need to be faithful no matter what you physically see right now, and see that you have a mission on this earth. The things that we cannot see, the scripture says, are eternal. But we live in a world that is all about external, right? It's all about how we look. It's all about our success. It's all about whether we have the right relationships. It's all about this that you see. And yet God says, I see what's inside. When he looked at David, he looked at the heart. That is the most important part of us. And as we work on that, we begin to see that those things, those accoutrements of the outside, don't really matter. That God desires for us to have, as we get older and wiser, to have a beautiful soul. And that beautiful soul is what gets onto the page. Your best work as a novelist, as a writer, is to do soul work in your heart, to know you are well and wildly loved by the creator of the universe, and then it flows out. I am sick and tired of reading books that are lifeless, where they say the same old boring cliches over and over again. I think I've read the same Christian book like 58 times. And I'm sick of it. We need new life. We need new metaphors. We need no more cliche. We need to let God be unique with us so that we can be unique on the page for other people. And with that mission in mind, that the whole world would see that light on the hill. I remember when we got back from France, and we had, for all intents and purposes, you know, I had left my dream behind, but God had saw fit to let me keep publishing, and I continued to publish after that. So my thought that my career was ending was not true. But we came back from France very defeated, and I received an email one day, and it was one of those great emails that you love. And in it, she said, there was this woman who was in her 20s, and she was trying to figure out how to discern God's will in her life. And so this is what she said. She said something like, okay, you went to France, and you failed, so you must not have heard from God and went there in the first place. So please tell me what you did wrong so I won't make that mistake again. Okay, let me tell you all about this. And it's, you know, I let it sit. It's always good to let things sit for a day, you know, because the first email I would have written would have been really snarky. But I prayed, and as I prayed and wrote back to her, there was a phrase that came to me, and I said, you know what? It's an American idea that if God isn't a thing, it will naturally prosper. And I think that has helped me to see that prospering is not all we think it is. I believe we do need to have our souls prospered. But it doesn't always look like fame, and it doesn't always look like acclaim, and it doesn't always look like a published book. It doesn't always look like everything that you want it to be. I believe God did call us to France, and he called us to be faithful and unnoticed. And he called us to ask another couple who were French, which was better. They spoke French way better than me. And to put them in that place. And now they are reaching marginalized Muslims for Christ in a way we never could have. But God brought us there to get them there. That was our job. There's no fanfare in that. But I'm so grateful for that journey. And I know that God called me to the place to suffer and that it was good. And I can always point back. And my poor friends are like, are you going to talk about France again? Because blah. But I can point back to that and go, oh my gosh, the growth, so much growth. We don't point back and say, oh, you know, I grew so much when everything was butterflies and ponies and everything was awesome. And my kids were rising up and calling me blessed, no rebellion, husband loves me. You know, it, like, no, we don't grow then. We stagnate or we sit on our laurels or whatever. But when our kid runs away, or when our husband's being mean or whatever, not my husband is never mean, but your husband might be mean. This is being taped. He might see this, so I gotta be careful. But you know, it's in those difficult times, right? Like those super difficult times that's where we kind of find out what our metal is. I was talking to a friend today, and he was talking about a friend of his who lost his wife. And I said, how's he doing? And he said, he's doing really well. And the only reason he's doing well is because Jesus has carried him through this. But you don't know that you need to be carried unless you're broken. And so why do we always run away from the thing that actually is going to grow us? I don't know. I'm not quite sure, but I think it's this avoidance of pain that we don't like. We were at a Christmas party after we were in the States for about 3 days and completely worn out and hurt by what had gone on in France. And I bumped into another professor, and lots of professors in my life. And we told him our story of what happened on the shores of France. And he said, you know, Mary, nothing significant in the kingdom of God ever happens unless death occurs. Think about that. You put a seed into the ground, it must die before it resurrects. It must break apart. It must, the hull must be pulled away. It must become unrecognizable before it produces a shoot from the ground and goes up into the sky through the dark, dark earth. After death comes resurrection, but we're not going to get that resurrection if we're not willing to die. Nothing significant in the kingdom of God happens unless death occurs. I am so grateful for that truth. I don't like it, but it's the truth. Some of you in this room are experiencing your own Golgotha right now. You are in your death place. Maybe it's death of a dream that involves writing. Maybe it's death of a marriage. Maybe it's death of a relationship. Maybe it's just death of your life is not going as you expected it to be, and you don't like it, and you're stamping your feet and just saying, I just want the American thing where everything's prosperous. Why can't it be? That's okay. You're in actually the most beautiful place you can be, cradled in the arms of your Father, getting you ready for the resurrection that will come in your soul. The soul that prospers comes from that dark place. So be encouraged if that is you today, because God is going to be doing some great resurrection even this weekend. Some of these things that you have questions about or are confused about, God's going to use this dark time to do something absolutely stunning and beautiful. There's a man whose name is Sixto Rodriguez, and that's my next slide. And some of you may know the story. There's a documentary out there called Searching for Sugar Man, and if you have not ever seen it, rent it on Netflix. It's free. It will change your life. There was a man in Detroit who was an amazing singer in the 70s. He made one album, and it just never quite caught on. But he was great. They compared him to a better Bob Dylan. They compared him to lots of awesome singers of his time. He was very gifted. But the album just never really went anywhere, and so he went back to his job as a metal worker and had a very, very sparse life. Eventually, he ran for some political things within the city, but really quiet life, and no one knew who he had been. But something happened in that time period where his album got smuggled somehow to South Africa. And his album became the anthem of the anti-apartheid movement. And he had no idea that this was going on. He had no idea that he was Elvis in South Africa. He was literally bigger than Elvis. And there had been a rumor in South Africa that he was on stage, and either he took a gun and shot himself on stage, or he set himself on fire. So all these people in South Africa, as things were changing and apartheid was being abolished, they were all sad that this awesome singer who had been the soundtrack of a revolution was gone and had gone in a flame of glory. Well, these people that were in the record industry decided one day that they were going to try to find this guy, Sixto, and find out what happened. Did he really kill himself, or did he really burn himself up, or whatever? They go on this long quest, and they start to discern through his lyrics that he's from Detroit. It had taken them a while to kind of figure out where he's from. So they go, and they find him alive, not killed, and they tell him that he is a big fat deal in another country. And he's like, what? I cannot believe that. They fly him to Cape Town, and he gives a concert, and it is a beautiful picture of our lives here on this earth. We may make our one album and think it does not matter a hoot, and yet when we get to the other side of the great crowd of readers, it might look something like this. This was the first time they saw him in South Africa, a filled stadium of a man they thought was dead.
Are you ready? Please welcome Rodriguez.
Nothing that you do is insignificant. And you may look around and think, where's the glory? But think about it. They found him in a very, very small apartment, impoverished, still a metal worker. He goes to the other side of the world and he's Elvis. And isn't that amazing? I think that's how the kingdom of God works, don't you think? The obscure become great, the last become first, the least become most, and we become faithful in small things Because our God is the God who sees. He is that big God who sees us. There's a quote by Oswald Chambers that has informed me all these years, and it is this: let the past sleep. We've talked about the past story, but let it sleep on the bosom of Christ. Give it to Jesus and go out into the irresistible future with him. You have an irresistible future. It may not look like what you expect it to look. I don't even know if I will write another book. I don't know what the future holds for me. I am going to be obedient to the light that shines at my footstep and do the next thing. If I keep looking up and trying to figure it all out, it's going to be a mess and a big hairdo. It is better to look down and go, what's my next step? And oftentimes that next step is one person in front of you, just dignifying them, listening to their story, praying for them, loving them. That is living a good story. That is writing a good story with your life. That is letting the author of all great stories write an adventure for you. And that is my heart for you, that you would go from this place longing to serve the God of adventure, longing to change the world, and remembering and reminding yourself that what you see in front of you is not all that matters. There's going to be a great crowd of readers on the other side. Write for them. Write for the acclaim on the other side. It's okay if you're living in an apartment in Detroit and you're a metal worker. You do what you do. You be faithful in those small things. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for this time that we have together this morning. You are big and we feel awfully small. But we also know that you love us so much. Help us to live for the applause of heaven and not the applause of today or of man. Help us to write words that change the landscape of the kingdom of God, not so we can be all that, so that we can point to you, the great I am, who is the storyteller who writes great adventures. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah.